So let's talk about adverse effects of cannabinoids. So obviously adverse effects is a political area because the government has said that cannabis is so dangerous that from its adverse effects it's not safe to use, but government studies, on the other hand, funded studies have shown that the adverse effects of cannabis really are within the range of effects tolerated for other medications. That was a statement written by the Institute of Medicine in 1999. Although smoking, they don't quite they felt was didn't have had some adverse effects that were beyond the range of other medications. However, they still said that in certain clinical indications, those adverse effects are not significant enough to stop from using it medically. It's important to know that there's really no lethal overdose with cannabis. There's no end organ damage that we are aware of, or what we call pure cannabis use, and therefore there's no particular laboratory values that one must follow when treating a patient with cannabis. Like if you're treating them with methotrexate, you want to watch liver function tests. Using chronic NSAIDs, you want to follow kidney functions. Those kind of labs are not needed. Few people develop dependence, but the risk factors for dependence similar to other forms of substance abuse. There is a distinct withdrawal syndrome with chronic cannabis use. It has been identified. It's mild and short-lived. It's not like alcohol or benzodiazepine withdrawals, which can be fatal. This withdrawal syndrome is characterized by restlessness, irritability, some mild insomnia, agitation, sleep, EEG disturbance, nausea, and cramping. Because of all those 6,100 patients that I was describing earlier that have been studied with cannabis cannabinoid trials, there's quite a bit of data available on adverse effects in controlled clinical settings using medical cannabinoids. A review published in 2008 in the Canadian Medical Association Journal concluded that 96.6% of the adverse effects reported in studies using medicinal cannabinoids, controlled clinical studies, were non-serious. Of the 164 serious adverse events that were reported, there was no evidence of a higher incidence of serious adverse events compared with control drugs. The FDA, again, has approved a most potent THC concoction, 100% THC. And this is what the product insert for that particular FDA product, which is approved by the FDA, says that you can have an overdose. And the symptoms would be euphoria, drowsiness, heightened sensory awareness, altered time perception, red conjunctiva, dry mouth, tachycardia. That's mild intoxication. Moderate, again, they say depersonalization, mood alteration, urinary retention, reduced bowel motility, and severe, lethargy, slurred speech, postural hypertension. Maybe panic reactions and seizures in patients with existing problems. The important thing is that there is no evidence-based studies that demonstrate that chronic cannabis use can cause or exacerbate schizophrenia. This is a very common refrain in the media that cannabis can make people go crazy, lead to permanent schizophrenia. Psychiatrist that I worked with in the past, Dr. Julie Holland, who edited the POT book, she says that really there's no way you can give yourself schizophrenia. That's how she put it. So, but there are potentially some associations that have been discovered between history of cannabis use and schizophrenia, but we don't know if that's a cause-effect relationship. So. There are no studies that should demonstrate that you can cause or exacerbate schizophrenia by using cannabis. There's no cannabis smoking studies that link cannabis with the development cannabis use with the development of COPD or lung cancer. And this has been studied in very large epidemiological studies. In fact, one of which was recently published in JAMA, Journal of the American Association, American Medical Association. In fact, there are protective effects of cannabis smoking seen that were seen in two large retrospective population-based case control studies that showed that you could cannabis smoking would protect you if you were also a smoker, tobacco smoker, getting reduce your risk of certain head and neck air digestive cancers. And in some cases, if you're just a cannabis smoker, you have lower incidence of those cancers in these epidemiological studies that were done out of UCLA and Brown University. There are rare hypersensitivity reactions to THC or allergies to inert materials in cannabis formulations. So those patients should avoid these cannabinoids altogether. Theoretically, there may be a risk with patients who have certain infections that are intracellular pathogens, like Legionella, which require Th1 immune activity for inhibition. And there's some studies that suggest that cannabis might shift to a Th2 immune arm. But these are theoretical risks, but something to be aware of. And then certainly, given the relationship between possible relationship with cannabis and psychosis, patients who have a personal or family history of psychosis, cannabis should be used carefully or cautiously with subjects. Carefully monitor. Okay, let's go to drug interactions. So clinically useful drug interactions, when THC is co-administered with CBD, as can occur with the usage of some strains of herbal cannabinoid medicines and certain cannabinoid-based extractions. So, drug interactions, the dronabinol insert, product insert. Okay, right here. So, before we go to the dronabinol product insert, let me just tell you that the interesting thing about CBD is that if you co-administer CBD with THC, many of the adverse effects of THC, as I was describing on the Marinol FDA insert label, can be mitigated. That's anxiogenic dysphoria, short-term memory interrupting effects of THC when you combine it with CBD, which is kind of a clinically useful drug interaction. You can find these cannabinoids together in substrates of herbal cannabis. I read somewhere that indica-dominant strains tend to have a higher THC to CBD ratio, or that is to say, more CBD to THC ratio. And this data, this evidence has come from all sorts of different studies, brain imaging studies to population-based studies and so on, surveys. Cannabinoid drugs can enhance the analgesic activity of opioids when they're co-administered. And that's been shown in animal studies and in human studies. And potentially clinically useful, this drug interaction can lead to reduction of dosing of opioids in patients who are receiving opioids for pain. The insert, package insert for FDA-approved package insert for THC pills says that THC pills have been used with a variety of different types of medications, antibiotics, anti-cancer drugs, sedatives, opioids, and there haven't been any clinically significant drug-drug interactions. Goes on to say cannabinoids may interact with other medications through both metabolic and pharmacodynamic mechanisms. Therefore, dronabinol THC, which is highly protein-bound, might displace other protein-bound drugs, although this has not been confirmed in vivo. This was a table that a pharmacy college in Barcelona, a professor there, had created on cannabis THC drug interactions with other classically commonly used drugs, TCAs, SSRIs, NSAIDs, barbiturates, etc. And I don't know if this was sort of his observations or sort of theoretical concerns, but things to know, patients are on beta blockers, that the tachycardia associated with THC can potentially be reduced if you are taking fluoxetine or Paxil, Prozac. You potentially can increase the effect of that with THC. And same thing with tricyclic antidepressants like amitriptyline, that THC can increase the side effects of amitriptyline.
Welcome to GoToMeeting. There are three other callers on the call.
Metabolism of theophylline, and therefore a dose increase might be required. and then atropine and scopolamine can increase the tachycardia produced by THC. So this is just some common sense. But just thought it's important to know some of these. This 2013 issue, I did a survey of the National Library of Medicine. In pain, and find out exactly how many of them showed that cannabinoids on cannabis had generated 38 of the survey criteria, and of those 38, 71% were positive studies, and 29% were negative. Table 2 here shows those various positive indications for cannabinoids. And they include experimentally induced pain in healthy volunteers, unspecified chronic non-cancer pain, chronic pain secondary to chronic upper motor neuron syndrome, cancer-related pain, chronic pain in fibromyalgia, chronic pain in rheumatoid arthritis, chronic pain in multiple sclerosis, chronic neuropathic pain with hyperalgesia and allodynia, and chronic neuropathic pain related to HIV, trauma, surgery, and complex regional pain syndrome. So the negative studies were post-op pain, 3, experimentally induced pain in healthy volunteers, 1 neuropathic pain and spinal cord injury study, 2 MS studies, 1 brachial plexus emulsion study, and 1 diabetic neuropathy study. One particular effort to further substantiate the use of cannabis medicine and evidence base for it was led by the state of California legislature when they allocated $8.7 million to a center for the establishment and running of a center for medicinal cannabis research that was based at UC San Diego. And that center really facilitated much of what's required to do cannabis-based studies in the United States, but gold standard clinical trials of cannabis, both smoked and vaporized, to be done over a 10-year period in the University of California medical centers, which involved over 300 in 2012, published in the Open Journal Neurology Journal. The authors reported that all trials independently show benefit. This is kind of a table of some of those various trials. This was taken from an American Medical Association report. I won't go through all of these here, but just to sort of show you how these studies are done, what they look like for example, this top one here, HIV, cannabis and painful HIV-associated sensory neuropathy, a randomized placebo-controlled trial published in Neurology in 2007, Donald Abrams, PI, involving 55 patients, and was randomized double-blind placebo-controlled, that's something to do in the crossover, but they used up to 3 cannabis cigarettes of 3.95% THC for 5 days, and they showed the pain 34%. and 53% of the patients showed a greater than 30% reduction in pain intensity. And also, they also showed that cannabis reduced the pain. And the experiment, the side effects were none to mild. So, just to kind of show you, this is these to this table, and the second is another study, and the third and fourth are two other studies, and the details on the design and outcomes of those different studies. Again, all of these were positive outcome, but these are the particular details: who the patients were, what the design was, what the strength of the cannabis was used. These are pictures from screenshots from a documentary called "Waiting to Inhale," which showed the clinical trial, the pilot clinical trial for that first Abrams study that I was reading to you on a couple of slides ago. This is the San Francisco General Hospital at University of UCSF Affiliated Medical Center. And this is showing how these trials are done. This is a pharmacist who is weighing out the cannabis from the container, their metal container from the Mississippi farm. On the bottom screen, you have a patient who's admitted to the center who is being advised to inhale that cannabis in a sort of controlled fashion. And then on the right is the visual analog scale that's used to determine the pain score before and after interventions. These are kind of results from that particular trial that show, this is how the results look like, that show that if you have two arms, placebo and active, that their pain scores before in the pre-intervention phase were on average the same, about 60. But when they were admitted to the hospital and had a two-day inpatient lead-in phase and a five-day intervention phase, that the patients who received cannabis, and they were blinded to whether they got cannabis or placebo, and some of the investigators, but those patients on statistically significantly reported drops in pain intensities, and those drops in pain scores did persist for a few days after the last cigarette was given on day five, but eventually, by day seven, the two pain scores in both groups had returned to the same level. So, just a little bit of a clinical trial analysis. Next, here we have the, this is another trial that was showing cannabis treatment of spasticity in multiple sclerosis. And this was also part of that California Medicinal Cannabis Research set of trials. And as you can see here, essentially these two graphs are spasticity as measured by mean combined scores on the modified Ashworth scale before and after treatment each day of each phase of the trial. And they're showing here that there is a drop of spasticity score after treatment only in the cannabis group, not the placebo group. A significant drop, the triangles are the active group. So the spasticity is up there at 9, and then it drops down to 7, and then they do it again, it goes from 9 to 7, 9 to 6. And same thing happens, but if you switch the two groups, the opposite effect occurs. The placebo people start dropping because they're now active, and the active group that's now placebo doesn't have a significant change. And then the right-hand side is another way to look at that data, and it just shows that before treatment, this is what they look like, and after treatment, this is what they look like. There's much more significant change in the modified Ashworth scale in the cannabis in this controlled clinical trial in MS. Okay. Next, we have, so that's a little bit more details on that particular trial, that there was a decrease in pain, and that there was also, there was no significant change in their ability to walk. There was some acute cognitive changes, but we're not really sure what the significance of those were. They're still within the normal range. The investigators wanted to note that standard treatments also affect cognition, methylphenidate, couple of people we did withdraw from the study. Two felt uncomfortably high, two felt dizziness, one fatigue. There was no episodes of bradycardia, tachycardia, hypertension, or hypotension, or medical intervention in this study. Because the cannabis extraction has had a lot of the one that I was showing you on prior slides, not just that extract, but another extract made by a German group called Cannador, alcohol-based cannabis extract. There's been a lot of funding to study cannabis extracts in clinical trials in Europe and also in the U.S., but predominantly Europe. We have large trials involving multi-center, involving hundreds and hundreds of patients, where cannabis-based medicines, extractions have been studied compared to standard treatments or placebo in MS in this one particular trial. Which showed that although there was, in a 15-week study, there was no change in Ashworth score, tremor, irritability, or tiredness, but there was a significant improvement in spasticity, pain, and sleep quality in the subjects who used the cannabis extraction, alcohol extraction. And it turned out that over the long term of that study, actually, over that 15-week period, there was less hospitalizations for relapses in the active treatment groups, both for patients who received cannabis extract or THC pills. Side effects were minor. Then they did a 12-month follow-up of 657 patients who were receiving the Cannador extract, and there was improvement in the spasticity, and there was also improvement in their ability to walk, the Riverbed Mobility Index, which showed reduced disability in these MS. And so they concluded that, actually, this particular conclusion is from a NIH summary by Pal Patcher and colleagues, that when they summed up the literature in 2006, this study I was just describing to you, here was about 2003-2004, that they concluded that there is a place for the use of cannabis in treatment of MS, which should be confirmed, they say, in further larger scale clinical trials. There's always it's always more research to be done, but it's important to know that, you know, National Institute of Health investigators in the U.S. have concluded that there is a role for the cannabis in the treatment of MS, and that there are large clinical trials to back that up. Okay, there's also been phase 3-level studies of cannabis done. Again, this is where the cannabis extract, this is the liquid CO2 extract of cannabis, and this was done to look at MS pain and patients with MS, and you can it just shows you here at the 10-week period in this phase 3 study that the cannabis extract, which combined both THC-rich and CBD-rich sprays, this was done at St. Bartholomew's Hospital in London, that there was a significant improvement in the pain from baseline after 10 weeks in the study period. There's been review articles published by Canadians. This was by Lynch and Campbell, who were at in Toronto. They did a study, this was in a trial. They summed up various trials. They found that in general that cannabis 15 of 18 trials that met their inclusion criteria demonstrated significant analogous effect of cannabinoid as compared to placebo. And several reported significant improvements in sleep. No serious adverse. This HIV-associated sensory neuropathy indication is an important one to note because, again, it turns out that in this particular study published in the Public Library of Science 1 2010, that really cannabis is the most efficacious treatment that has been studied for this form of pain, compared to gabapentin, Lyrica, pregabalin, topocapsaicin, amitriptyline. Cannabis has the lowest number needed to treat compared to any of those particular interventions when you're looking at randomized controlled trials. So really, this should be the first line treatment. Okay, so now the last portion of the talk, I'm going to just show you a couple of cases that I had published in the Journal of Opioid Management in 2009, and this was part of my doctoral research at the University of Washington, where this is a copy of the article where 139 patients' medical records were reviewed at a rehabilitation medicine pain specialist clinical site in rural western Washington. And again, the case study is sort of like you can take it two ways. You know, if it's if you don't like it, it's an anecdote. If you do like it, it's a case history. So this is where the study was conducted here in southwestern Washington. And this is a picture of the medical records of the whole clinic for all their rehab patients. And then down here below, I had pulled out the charts of the patients who had been authorized to use cannabis for medicinal purposes. This is pre-EMR days. So 87% of the subjects were male. They were on average about 47 to 48 years of age. In total, there were 236 years of cannabis medicinal authorized use in the sample. On average, 1.7 years. Their zip codes, plus the first three digits, show that most of them came from the area near where the clinic was located, but there were some that came from far away in eastern Washington. These were the various pain syndromes that were documented in this patient sample. A large variety of pain syndromes. And this was their frequency of the distribution of those pain syndromes. Most myofascial pain syndromes, second highest neuropathic pain syndromes, third highest. Discogenic pain syndromes, then osteoarthritic pain, central pain, fibromyalgia, visceral pain, spinal cord injury, rheumatoid arthritis pain. This is a pain classification scheme that was used in some standard textbooks. And I thought it was interesting to note that most patients had more than one part of pain syndrome. Actually, no one over age 65 had more than just one pain syndrome present. So, qualitatively, we can say that this sample of patients really had all kinds of conditions. There was TBI patients, hep C patients, gunshot wounds, shrapnel wound injuries, SCIs, ALS, PLS, even a myotonia congenita patient, 19 with fibromyalgia, one with HIV. So let's take a snapshot of some of these cases. There was one 52-year-old male with chronic back, bilateral leg, bilateral shoulder pain, secondary to degenerative joint disease, failed back surgery syndrome, and multiple rotator cuff repairs. So he was patient number 101. I classified him as having myofascial pain, neuropathic pain, osteoarthritic pain, and discogenic pain. In his chart, it indicated that he had been medical with cannabis authorized for 5 months. The chart indicated that he had been using marijuana on his own. He feels it gives him the best pain relief of anything that he has used. 2 to 3 inhalations of marijuana, cigarette 2 to 3 times a day, improves his pain levels drastically without incapacitating him. He was also on NSCOT. And I didn't have enough information to indicate whether he had reduced his dose of using cannabis. It's also interesting to note that he was adamant to state that he was not a recreational drug user, and stated quite a number of times during the visit that he was embarrassed to inquire about use of cannabis. An 18-year-old male with chronic head and neck pain and a dramatic secondary to TBI, he had been struck by a motorhome while being a bicyclist and had a GCS score of 4 on the CD. So he was classified as myofascial pain and central pain syndrome. He had been authorized to use medical cannabis for 4 months, and his pain scores were, he was using it daily, his pain scores went from 8 or 9 out of 10 to 2 to 3 out of 10 after just 2 to 3 inhalations. He was noted that it was difficult for him to tolerate opioid medications when patients can't tolerate the side effects of opioids, pruritus or constipation or cognitive dysfunction. A barrier to note is that the Department of Corrections in the state was disallowing his use of cannabis. A 35-year-old male who had severe ulnar neuropathy, who had had surgical repair, who also had osteoarthritic-related low back pain and hip pain, classified him as having myofascial neuropathy and osteoarthritic pain. He had been using cannabis medicine for over 2.5 years, and essentially no side effects reported, and that there was also rare use of Percocet. There was a 39-year-old with chronic daily migraine headaches, myofascial pain, who had a cyst in the subarachnoid cyst in the left temporal lobe, and multiple musculoskeletal problems. It was classified as having myofascial pain, central pain, osteoarthritic pain. Had been using medical cannabis for 7 months and had excellent results with respect to migraine headaches, using about less than a quarter ounce a week. She was also using gabapentin. It was a 65-year-old male who was diagnosed with ALS since 2004. And he'd had the diagnosis for 3 years. Terminal illness, obviously, and increasing weakness, pain, dysphagia, dysarthria, and had a G-tube placed. And just, you know, I didn't have much details on his response, but he had been using cannabis for 3.8 years, and that's quite a significant lifespan for the ALS patient. I should note that colleagues and I have published research articles suggesting that cannabis should be used in clinical trials for ALS because there's a lot of basic science that indicates that there may be a disease-modifying effect. Similar to what we saw with the MS patients in the prior slide, having improved walking, there may be some improved loss of motor neurons, less oxidative damage, motor neuron diseases with the use of cannabis cannabinoid medicines, and it really should be studied. There was a 50-year-old male with chronic abdominal pain, secondary chronic active hepatitis C. Somebody, he also had chronic back pain, secondary to cervical lumbar degenerative joint disease, disc disease. He had had a splenectomy. He had a history of a panic disorder. I classified it as myofascial pain, disc degenerative pain, and visceral pain. He had been using cannabis medicine when he authorized for 13 months. He stated that it had helped him substantially, and that he tolerated it much better than opioids, that he decreased his dependence on opioids. He was previously taking 40 to 80 milligrams of oxycodone twice a day. And now he's completely off. He'd been completely off of oxycodone. We're only using PRN, Vicodins. 53-year-old male, chronic cervical myelopathy, secondary to stenosis, with a history of an anterior cervical discectomy infusion, chronic neuropathic pain with radicular symptoms, history of chronic rotator cuff impairment on the left, status of post surgical repair, and history of lumbar degenerative joint disease, disc disease, erosive osteoarthritis, and shovels. Myofascial pain, neuropathic pain, osteoarthritic pain, dysphagic pain. He'd been using medical cannabis for 14 months. He said that he was using it to control his pain with good luck. He's also used oxycodone and oxycontin, but had tried to limit the dosage of that. And he did report side effects with the use of opioids, such as constipation and nausea. He also was using other NSAIDs and received cortisone injections. One doctor had been documented in his papers saying that he does need to quit using marijuana for safe general anesthesia. That is to say, if one doctor said that in order for him to feel comfortable putting him under general anesthesia for his surgery, that marijuana would have to be stopped. There's no indication that that is a barrier to safe general anesthesia that I'm aware of. Okay, I think that's enough for the cases, because a few more here. Oh, let me just share these last two, and we can go to the summary. I was a 22-year-old male with chronic back pain, secondary to a history of spinal compression fractures, T10 to T12, and status post-fusion. He had suffered trauma on February 23, 2003, with a snowboarding accident at White Pass. He went off a jump, came down on the right shoulder, and had this excruciating pain. He had been using medical cannabis for 1.8 years. Under this authorization, and there was a report in this chart that he was poorly tolerable to opioids, which he found too sedating. He had tried some other opioid adjuvants, such as Cymbalta, ibuprofen, tramadol, Flexeril, true-point injections, none of which he felt that had been very helpful. And he had been referred because the partner physician, the other physician, would not authorize his use of cannabis. A 33-year-old female with HIV-related peripheral neuropathy who was on dual ARV treatment, who had basically been HIV positive since diagnosis since 1999 through exposure via unprotected sex, who also had a history of fibromyalgia and major depressive disorder. She was using cannabis for 2.313 years, using about 2 ounces a month, 2 grams a day to smoke to relieve pain, sometimes more. The pain scores would drop from 7 or 8 out of 10 to 2 or 3 out of 10. She reported that she did not tolerate narcotics, which make her nauseated and worsen her appetite. She reported allergies to morphine and Demerol. She was authorized by a previous medical doctor who had then left the country and the location and was no longer able to authorize her. And she had been arrested due to possession of marijuana. And in her records, the physician wrote that she was in good condition for medical marijuana at the time of arrest, given what we know about the evidence that cannabis can help with HIV neuropathy. Quite clear that she was a good candidate. So there was a lot of hurdles, for patients accessing medical cannabis, such as prior physicians almost authorized, legal problems related to use, difficulties finding affordable, consistent supply. There's a lot of specific data in the review that showed medical cannabis was better than other pain medications used in the past. In some cases, it was the only medication found effective. In 26 patients in this particular case series. But the methodology of the study does make it difficult to make definitive statements regarding the relationship between opioid and medical cannabis use, although there were certain cases where cannabis or opioid dose reductions did occur. There was nobody that ceased cannabis use for any reason. This study helps to document deconstruct the myths about the kinds of patients accessing medical cannabis treatment. It's not young males in this particular study. They're not malingerers, they're not feigning disease to access cannabis. And the diagnostic data, both subjectively and objectively, showed medical cannabis patients are middle-aged women and men with complex medical problems. And such results from a tertiary pain rehab clinic directed by a qualified physician in academic medicine should help to dispel stereotypes about valid and invalid treatment with botanical and non-botanical cannabinoid-based medicines, a la Dr. Pott and Dr. Patton, referring to this particular part two that the United States government, through the Drug Enforcement Agency under the Department of Justice, had paid for to educate children on a website to teach them about the hype, quote-unquote, about medical marijuana, and showing that essentially to teaching the youth that cannabis was sort of authorized by an irresponsible physician who's using it himself and not able to participate in proper medical evaluation, and saying smoke 3 weeks and call me in the morning, versus a physician using cannabis pills with RX and shiny label and big smile, showing that they can relieve some side effects of chemotherapy. But essentially, this is, and trying to invalidate purely botanical cannabinoid medicines in favor of purely chemical cannabinoid medicines. So, but hopefully this type of data can help dispel the stereotypes. And that's the end of the presentation. And thank you for your time. And turn it back over to Amish.